More than 2 million eviction court cases are filed in the US each year, with the majority involving low-income and minority households. This has spurred concern over the cost for tenants and local governments, and motivated a growing interest in policies to curb evictions. Yet, despite these trends, quantitative empirical research on the consequences of eviction has been fairly limited. It is difficult to link eviction data to other outcomes, and because eviction is often correlated with, or even precipitated, by other sources of distress, it is not obvious how to isolate its impact. This paper overcomes these challenges using newly constructed data based on housing court records from New York City and Cook County, Illinois. In these, as in most jurisdictions, the eviction process begins with a notice served to the tenant by the landlord, and ultimately runs through housing court, where a judge decides whether to issue an eviction order requiring the tenant to vacate the property. The authors link these court records to a broad range of administrative data, which allows them to track tenants' outcomes before and after their eviction case, and they isolate the causal impact of eviction by exploiting the random assignment of cases to judges. To start, they characterize the set of tenants at risk of eviction. Each year, around 33,000 cases are filed in housing court in Cook County, and approximately 65% end with an eviction order. In New York, roughly 240,000 cases are filed, and around 30% end with an eviction order. Evictions occur throughout both jurisdictions, but are clearly concentrated in neighborhoods with higher poverty rates. Within these areas, tenants who appear in housing court are negatively selected. They have lower earnings and employment relative to randomly chosen tenants living in the same neighborhood, and within housing court, differences persist between evicted and non-evicted tenants. These figures show trends in earnings and employment in the 16 quarters before and the 24 quarters after an eviction filing. Both groups show a decline in earnings and employment in the year prior to the case filing, and this decline is steeper for the evicted. Similar patterns appear when looking at financial health and measures of health outcomes. All point to higher levels of distress in the years prior to a filing, and these changes are more pronounced for those who are ultimately evicted. These patterns underscore two key points. First, they are consistent with the idea that eviction filings often coincide with other events, such as a health shock or losing a job. This makes it difficult to isolate the causal effect of eviction alone. Second, the fact that the evicted and non-evicted differ in both levels and trends in the years before a filing suggests there are unobservable factors that may affect a household's probability of eviction and their post-court outcomes. This means that simply comparing the two groups would yield a biased estimate of the effects of eviction. To overcome this, the authors use the fact that in both jurisdictions, housing cases are randomly assigned to judges who, in turn, systematically vary in their tendency to evict. The most stringent have high mean eviction rates in the data, while the least stringent have low mean eviction rates. There is meaningful variation in judge stringency in both locations, and the probability of receiving an eviction order is substantially higher for tenants who are assigned to more stringent judges. So, to isolate the causal effect of eviction, the analysis focuses on tenants who received an eviction order because they happened to be randomly assigned to a more stringent judge. The results show that in the immediate aftermath of an eviction, tenants experience a spike in residential mobility and homelessness. These trends are apparent in the comparisons between evicted and non-evicted tenants, but the analysis with judge stringency confirms they are a causal effect of eviction. In the first year after case filing, an eviction order increases the probability of observing the tenant at a new address by 28%, and the probability of staying in emergency shelters by over 300%. These effects persist through the second year after filing, and this period of housing instability coincides with a drop in earnings. Quarterly earnings fall by 8% in the first year, by 14% in the second year, and these effects are especially pronounced for female and Black tenants. There is also an increase in hospital visits and in visits for mental health-related conditions. Finally, beyond this initial period, eviction worsens tenants' financial health in the long run. Up to 6 years after the filing, evicted tenants have higher debt levels and lower credit scores. Thus, this paper shows that eviction exacerbates the economic distress experienced by tenants in the lead-up to a court filing. These findings contribute to the debate around eviction-related policies, and they suggest there may be substantial private and public benefits to curbing evictions, especially given the high cost to local governments of providing healthcare and addressing homelessness. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes many papers in sociology that study eviction, as well as economics research on the drivers of eviction filings and the impact of foreclosures.